black teachers, but in January of 1970, Dr. Simington had a new white teacher. The teacher transfer was one of the first steps towards full integration of the Winston-Salem and Forsyth County school system. Next we have Ms. Norma Corley. Ms. Corley is the school counselor at Hillwood Elementary School. In 1958, Ms. Corley was one of three black students assigned to integrate the formerly all-white Easton Elementary School. Because of Corley and her two classmates, Easton became the first integrated elementary school in the county. And finally, we have Ms. Daisy Chambers. She was part of an early experiment of transferring teachers in the county. She was one of 25 teachers who were reassigned to different schools as a way of pushing towards integration. She had been teaching at the all-black North Elementary, but in 1964, she was sent to the previously all-white Clemmons Elementary. In fact, Clemmons became the first, Ms. Chambers became the first black faculty member at Clemmons. So let's welcome all of our guests, please. And now we're going to begin. So before integration, there were tangible differences between the black schools and the white schools. Often the white students had access to new materials like textbooks and science equipment, and the black schools got what was left over, what was already used, and sometimes tattered. So for all of you, would you tell me about some of the other known differences between the white schools and the black schools?
Well, you mentioned about the material and the textbooks. May I make just a statement before we start? I'm the senior citizen here. And I began my career in Columbia, South Carolina. Came to Winston-Salem in Mebane School and then transferred to North. Somebody's shaking their head. So I was at Winston-Salem for South Carolina school system as a teacher for only a few years, and I was assigned to Clemmons Elementary. And I'm giving you this background information so to help you understand my transition of what I realized from being in an all-black school where everything was pretty much the material hand-me-down. We were told in high school that the material came from Reynolds. I don't know whether that was true or not, but that's what we were told. Everything was very strict. At the end of the year, you had to give an account of how you handled your textbooks. If you had anything written in them, you had to erase it out and get your books ready for the next year. Now, to me, this was pretty normal because I didn't know anything else. When I went to Clemmons, I was following the same pattern that I followed in the black school in which I worked and in which I was a student. And I would say, well, are we going to get our books? Well, the book's in the classroom. What? You don't have to give an account of every book that you have and make sure that it was assessed, graded, so at the end of the year they knew how much to charge? No, the books are in the classroom. I always made my material. You're very creative. When I went to Clemmons, there was a room with equipment in it. Well, how do you get the equipment? You must go through a long process. I didn't say these things, but you know, in my mind, you must go through a long process. No, you go get what you need, put it back when you finish, and then move on. I have to mention Frank Morgan. Some of you may know William Frank Morgan is my mentor today. But he was my principal at Clemmons Elementary. As has been said, I was the first African-American teacher. I was not anxious about my assignment at all. I'm kind of drifting back and forth. I wasn't anxious because I had developed a certain amount of confidence in my teaching. I was a student at Winston-Salem State. My teachers were very demanding. To give you how demanding. Miss Butler, if you were writing the word hit, H-I-T, and if your dot was not over the I. She would circle it and say that you misspelled it. So we were very meticulous about what we did. And that was how I got to Clemmons, by the way. But anyway, at Clemmons, I wasn't concerned about teaching. I really wasn't concerned about relationships, because my relationship was with my home base. I've always been an active participant in church. So I said, well, I'll go to Clemmons, which I didn't want to go because it was, to me, in another world. I had to get on 40 and drive and drive and drive and drive. Mm-hmm. And so I really didn't want to go for that reason. But when I got there, I said, well, I'll go and I'll teach, because I was confident in that. And then I'll come home and I'll continue my relationships. But that wasn't the case. Thanks to Frank Morgan, and I know you probably want me to just talk about equipment and material, but Frank Morgan was a man who I think would scare anybody when you first meet him, because he would not look at you, and he would just doodle as he talked with you. Do I need this mic? Do I need the mic?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Okay, he would just doodle as he talked with you. And I knew, well, I can get along with him, you know, anybody. But he came in my room one day and he said, we're having a PTA meeting, we can sing. And I said, well, your first question should be,
can
you sing? An assumption was made there. So anyway, that ended. And then he sent me a note and said, let's talk. And I thought, talk about what? And the other teachers there were saying, Daisy, what have you done? Because he wanted you to be a little bit fearful, to stand in awe of him. He said, what have you done? I said, I don't know what I've done. But what didn't you do? And they would help me. Did you do this? Did you do that? Didn't you do this and didn't you do that? Well, they came for me to go into the office where he was, and I sat down. And he said, well, do you know where the books are located? I said, yes. Do you know where the equipment is located? Yes. Do you know where so-and-so was? Yes. Do you know? Yes. And then he said, okay, you may leave. His strategy was not to tell me where things were, but to force me to interact with the other staff members to find out where the things were. But when he said, okay, you may go, the tears flowed. And then I saw the other side. And I know I always give a tribute to Frank Morgan because he's special even to this day. He came around on that side of the desk and hugged me and said, well, he didn't have a clue as to what was wrong. He said, what's wrong? And I said, I thought I had done something wrong. And, you know, I didn't know. And he said, no, I just wanted to make sure that you have adjusted to this environment. Clemmons at that time had maybe 900 students. Each grade level had 5 or 6 teachers. So it was a lot of people to interact with. When I came out from his office, the staff members were sort of standing out. What happened? What happened? So I told them that was the beginning of really a delightful fellowship at Clemmons Elementary. I didn't feel at all that I was an African-American teacher there. I knew I was African-American, no doubt about it. But I didn't feel like I stood out at Clemmons. And I can go on and tell you some other reasons why. But all of them relate to Frank, well, most of them relate to Frank Morgan. Now I'll be quiet so somebody else can talk.
Does anyone else have anything to add?
I only went to Black school for 1 year. So I started at Easton in the second grade. So the memories I have of the differences really came from my interacting with people in my neighborhood. And so I do know that when I went to Parkland High School, that for every one book, my neighbor had an Anderson. I had 3 to 5 books. I do know that. But in terms of any other discrepancies, I can't speak to that.
Good evening.
Good evening.
First of all, I'd just like to say I'm privileged to be on the panel with these two ladies. Ms. Chambers, who I know for a long time, not only was she a first in the classroom, but she also has some first other things that hopefully she will share, as well as being with Ms. Corley, who I've had the privilege.
And your mother.
And she said, and Ms. Corley, who I've had the privilege of working with for a number of years, I don't really necessarily have first, other than I went to Carver in 1967, but the first school that I attended was North Elementary. North Elementary was off of Patterson Avenue, and there was a post office there. So anyway, our family moved off of Carver School Road. The only thing I remember about materials is that when we moved, when I was in the first grade, I never had a math book in the first grade. We moved in October. And I just assumed that there were no materials for new students. And so this is going to sound bad, but I was always happy when somebody was absent because I could use their math materials. And I'm in the first grade, you might remember, we had those hands and you had the fingers, we were learning to count. So I was always happy to have some of these materials. But by and large, I think that's really the only memory I have about the materials.
Something I need to share with you about my assignment to North. When I came to Winston-Salem, I was at Mebane, and I was transferred after 1 year to North. I completed work on my master's degree while I was at North. The next year, I was transferred to Clemmons. Master's degree in elementary education, transferred. The teacher who replaced me at North had not received a college education. You heard what I said, had not received a college education. So what happened in her classroom, I don't know, because I was out at Clemmons. But the thing I have to say about integration and Clemmons and the equipment and the building, Frank Morgan made one statement that I recall to the staff. And it's one, I told you, if you don't know him, he's kind of a peculiar person. He doesn't do a lot, when I say peculiar, he doesn't do a lot of talking. He makes a statement and then he backs it up. When I told you I cried, I saw a tender side of him that many staff members had never seen at that school. He was a military person, maybe that's what I'm describing. You know, everything was to the line. But anyway, he made one statement. In the first staff meeting, he said, integration is here to stay. And if there's anybody here who does not want to be a part of integration, after this meeting, come and talk with me, and I'll help you go wherever you desire to go. The beginning of the statement and the end, I never heard anything else. I fell in love with the staff there, with the teachers there. We bonded, and the one time I thought that I was being ignored as an African-American teacher, there was a staff member who passed my door every morning and never spoke. Most of the teachers spoke, but she never did. So what did I assume? That she didn't want me there. She didn't like me. She didn't know me, only because I was African American. But she was getting married soon. And one of the children in my classroom brought her announcement to the class, you know, for show and tell. We said show and tell then. And so I put her picture on the bulletin board. And the next time she came down the hall, she saw the announcement. She came into the room and started talking. And we had the best conversation. When she left the room, she didn't say goodbye. She just left. The next morning, when she passed my door, she didn't speak. I found out she was, now I know somebody here is going to get me for saying this. She was a northerner. And you know many southerners, we do a lot of talking and speaking. She talked when she had something to say, but she just wasn't one to stand around and gab. So then I found, okay, Daisy, you were wrong. You were wrong. And really, that is the only experience, negative experience that way. Now, I'm not saying some of the, I didn't have difficulty with some of the parents. Most of them came, I don't think it was because I was African American, as much as they didn't trust my teaching. Can this teacher, who was educated in a black school, a master's in a white school, was Indiana, but then they didn't know that, but this teacher was trained in a black school, teaching my child, who is probably going, you know where Clem, going to Harvard, a Duke, a Yale, does she have the skills to help prepare my child? So then I had to prove my, and I know Frank Morgan got some questions, but he never shared any of them with me. And my first year there, my class was all white. One lady came because I started with, at second grade, with knowing, learning the ABCs. So she was indignant. My child, who is Harvard bound, you are teaching the ABCs. My child can read and some writing. I said, yeah, I'm not doubting that. You may know that, but I have to find it out. So as was my habit, I started with everybody at point zero. Then when I determined where he or she was, then I would adjust the curriculum to meet that child's needs. So it was individualizing the instruction. We didn't call it that then. But this one lady who was going to take me before the Board of Education for not moving her child along faster, and the same was true for math and every other subject. By the end of the month, when her child was doing research work in the media center, he was smart. He's a lawyer in Charlotte. He was smart as all get out. But she was concerned that I wasn't going to adjust my teaching to meet his needs. So that's just a little bit of extra about what life was for a black teacher in an all-white school. And the only other African-Americans in the school were the custodians, and they were wonderful. They were loving, wonderful people.
So can both of you tell me about your experiences of students in an integrated school?
In terms of our teaching or?
Whatever you'd like to share.
Okay.
All of it.
What I did find out about my experience at Easton, and this is 2 years before Ruby Bridges. This is 1958. Jesus was not born yet. And that was supposed to be a joke. I did find out that so many white parents took their students, their children, out of Easton that Forest Park had to run two shifts. 8 to 12 and 12 to 4. And it was so funny, back in February, I spoke at Easton, and the school reporter, Kim Underwood, was one of those students at Forest Park. And he said he was caught up in it, but he didn't even know why. Later on, the newspaper, the journal, did an article on us. I think it was the 40th anniversary of that desegregation. I do not call it integration. I still don't think we've integrated. So I got calls from parents that amazed me, who apologized for doing that, but they had taken their children out of school. I can't address what fear or what triggered that, but anyway, that was our experience. The three young blacks that went to Easton, each one of us handled our situation differently. Ricky was in third grade. He was a year ahead of us, and you know, he was more athletic, so he was into the sports. Rosalind said that she fought all the time, so she was in the office. And I made straight A's. I was gonna show everybody that I was smart, and I was just as smart as, you know, anybody else. And so, now Rosalind and Ricky's experience, and I can't really speak for them, but I do know that it was traumatic to the point that after sixth grade, they went back to Anderson. They did not go on in white school. So when I went to Hill, I was the first black and the only black in that school for 2 years until my sister and brother came. And I asked a teacher later on, I said, well, what do you remember about my being at Hill? And he said, you looked like a deer caught in headlights. But everything was so new. We didn't have a manual. Now, my mom had taught us about the golden rule, so that was our manual that we were going by. But everybody, you know, had not read the same book. And we're not practicing the same thing. So we had the experience of being friends in school, but outside, if we were seen, they didn't know us. I mean, that was just the norm. They didn't know us. But in school, you know, we were rubbing elbows, and they had come to know us. But outside, they didn't know us. And I had this experience in high school where I had helped this young lady plan a party. I'm thinking I'm going to the party. You know, I'm helping her plan. And she said, Norma, you can't come to my house. I said, okay.
It's interesting for me to think back to when I was 8 years old, and I was in the third grade at Carver, and when we started the school year, we had one teacher, and then after the holiday, we had a new teacher. And as an 8 year old, we knew that we were getting a new teacher, we liked our first teacher. But then in the fourth grade, so I grew up off the Carver school road, and we walked to school. And it was a good little ways. It was more than a mile, but we walked to school. In the fourth grade, I went to Prince Ibrahim. And Ibrahim is off of old Walkertown Road. And for an eight-year-old, even though now I think about it, it's not very far. But as an eight-year-old, it was a world away. I'd never been across that railroad track. I had never been past a store that was about a mile in the other direction from where I lived. And so all of our neighborhood, for the first time, we rode a bus to school. So we had never ridden a bus. And this was a new neighborhood, lots of children. And so we all went to Ibrahim. And what I came to know now that I work for the school system, is that was the beginning of the 3-3-2-2-2 system. So I went to Carver in those 3 years, and then I went to Prince Ibrahim for 4th, 5th, and 6th grade. And then I went to Walkertown Junior High. So Carver, I grew up right around Carver. I went to Walkertown Junior High, still rode the bus. And then in the 9th and 10th grade, I went back to Carver. Carver 1-3, Ibrahim 4-6, Walkertown 7-8, Carver 9-10, and then in the 11th and 12th grade, I went to East Forsyth. So that was, as Ms. Corley says, the plan that desegregated the schools. And so we found ourselves at Ibrahim. But one of the experiences that I didn't think about until I was an adult is each of my teachers, the largest school, we probably had three teachers in each grade at Carver. But at Ibrahim, we had probably five teachers. But in the fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, and I still remember those teachers, I had a black male, female teacher. Now that probably just happened. But that was a good thing for me because they nurtured me, they encouraged me. And when I was in Carver, we had groups. And when I got to Ibrahim, we had groups, but we changed classes. And most of the classes that I was in for reading and math, none of my friends were in there. And so I didn't really like that. I wanted to go with my friends and be with them. But they basically said, nope, you're going to that class in fourth, fifth, and sixth. At Walkertown, one of the interesting things is I was in the eighth grade, I ran for student body president. And at that time, we had two student body presidents, one black and one white. And then when I went to Carver, I think that's when I probably started to understand that students who went to Walkertown, that was really the first time that they actually came to school out of their neighborhood. And it's a long way from Walkertown to Carver. And then again, when I went to East, this kind of dual, this is the system becoming one. And I didn't know this really even until after I graduated, although I was escorting one of the girls at two homecoming queens, one black and one white. So those things were, they never said to us, we have a black homecoming queen, we have a white homecoming queen. We kind of knew that. And so I think that was part of the transition. And we were in the early years of integration. So I think that was done to make sure that everyone felt.
The year before the schools were integrated, I'm using the word integrated, you know, mixed, if you want to call it, I was asked to serve on a committee. If I remember correctly, it had about 24, 25 members. And Ellen Forsyth, some of you may know her, she's deceased now, was the chair. And we worked all summer, paid to work all summer to come up with some strategies to integrate the schools in Winston-Salem, Forsyth County. We thought we had an excellent plan, and we thought we would be ready, the school system would be ready by the beginning of the school year. But the school system did nothing. So in the middle of the year, the federal government, the court said, the schools will integrate now. So I was there when the teachers came, the students came, when the schools were mixed. And I'm telling you, that was a difficult time. And I share with you that the teachers with whom I worked at Clemmons, we just got along well. Even when we would see each other downtown, we would recognize each other. And we still are friends, many of them. Many of the same teachers that I started with, now we have lunch together and we talk. But many fell apart. Because they were assigned, some of them were assigned, these were all white teachers, to black schools. And they said, Daisy, for the first time in my life, I will be a minority. And I thought I could handle it, but I can't. And we had teachers to go to the hospital. We had teachers to go to the doctor. Some left the school. I mean, the teachers I worked with. Some left the school system, and my dearest person, the one who was the closest to me at Clemmons, was assigned to Carver. She ended up in the hospital. She said, Dave, I don't understand it. I thought I would be able to handle it. but surrounded with people not like me, I just couldn't deal with. And I'm telling you, this was a struggle. Now, I had more African-American teachers assigned to Clemmons after that. Then I became their mentor. I showed, you know, the ropes, because I had been at the school for a few years. And so that was a blessing. And the teachers, some of them could not, when the children came, could not handle many of the children who came. There is a difference in how some children are managed. And many of the teachers at Clemmons with whom I worked were the kind that you just reason with. You know, you sit down and you reason. Some of the children who were assigned, I call them raw products. They had not had many of the experiences. I said they were born and they appeared in school. So those children, not all of them, but many of them, they needed a different type of management style, which many of the Caucasian teachers had not learned. When you're in a black school, you got to do it all. You got to deal with everybody. And so we learned some discipline strategies that many of the white teachers did not have, because we had to. And that served us well at this particular time. It didn't hurt that I was president of the Association of Classroom Teachers. So I was asked to go to court to tell somebody what was happening in the schools. And my principal came and said, Daisy, I'm gonna get a sub for you for tomorrow so that you can go. Doug Punger, no, it was Bill Pfefferkorn, was my lawyer. And I think Doug Punger, I can't remember who the school system lawyer was, but this school system lawyer came to me to tell me what to say in court. My principal got the sub for me so that I could go to court. And then I said to each one of them, I think you should have asked me if I would do this, and I will not. I spent all summer coming up with a plan that we thought would be profitable and compassionate. And now that we were forced to do it and all these things are happening, I will not go and testify on behalf of the school system. Now, Pfefferkorn and I got together because he told me, he said, I mean, I thought I was going to be fired. He said, Daisy, you go in tomorrow. Ignore everything that they've said. You go in tomorrow, you go into your classroom and you teach. And if anybody says anything to you, call me and then I will take it from there. So you're talking about somebody being scared to go, because I thought, surely you're going against the school system, they're gonna fire you. I went to work, I went into my classroom, I nervously talked, and nobody ever said anything to me. I was thankful for that, but I also had to stand on my principal's seat. When you are, I'm gonna say this, when you try to live a righteous life, then you have to stand on your principles. And I knew that that was one time. And never again was I faced with anything similar to that. When I went to court, it was when I was taking I was taking not somebody to court, but as a principal. And you understand that sometimes parents and things, you have to go to court. But that was one time that I'm not a very fearful person, but I was really scared because I needed my job, I had a daughter to rear, and I thought I was gonna be fired, which meant that perhaps I couldn't get a job somewhere else.
Now, Flash forward, Clemmons Elementary School has one black classroom teacher now. They have a black teacher who's AG, but you know, she doesn't have a set class. When I left there, we had two or three black teacher assistants. So the whole climate has changed.
So how integrated was life, student life outside of the classroom?
It was, for me, it was Neil. As I said before, when we were out in public, the kids didn't know me. And I'm sure Rosalind and Ricky would attest to that fact too. But it's really strange because I felt as though I was a man or a woman without country. Because I was in a white school, the black kids thought, I thought I was better than they were. Of course, I didn't fit in with the whites because I was black. So I was just, you know, I was just a loner, I guess is the best way to describe it, but a woman without a country. And so it's really funny how the Lord works out things now, because now I'm in church with a lot of those kids I went to school with. So that's funny, that's really funny. And I hear it all the time about, well, no, I didn't, and you know, so you have to forgive and forget. But it was not easy walking through that when it was happening.
In my experience, our neighborhoods were so separate that there was no interaction outside of school, because we rode the bus to school and vice versa, so there was really no interaction. But in school, the place where I think there was the most integration happened in sports. And I played sports, primarily basketball, and so for boys at least, that was a place where you would see football team, basketball team, that kind of thing. Not so much, you know, the typical things in the lunchroom. You ate with who was in your class when you were in elementary and middle school. In high school, you could eat wherever you wanted to, but sports is probably the most dominant in those things.
Now, I did participate in sports. None of the other, when I went to high school, none of the other black women were doing that, so I was the only black person in the female sports.
There were 25 teachers who were part of that initial integration group, and we met monthly to see how we were adjusting, how we were going along, and so forth. And we did this for about a year, and many people struggled at their schools, but as I shared with you earlier, that wasn't my case. But after Frank Morgan asked me to serve as his assistant principal, his philosophy is to train you. You're not sure you're a military man. So he had me breaking down a boiler. It was a coal boiler. He had me driving the school bus. I had to get my license to drive the school bus. He had me doing, understanding what the custodians did. One year he told me to organize the school. It was the end of the year for the next year. Everything, you will organize everything. The room assignments and all of this, and it was quite a challenge, but I felt so good. I said, I spent all summer, and I'd go and ask him questions, and he'd always answer the questions. And I came up with this little plan, and I thought I had done something wonderful. And he looked at it, he said, well, where's this group gonna be? Oh, I forgot them. Well, what are you going to do for this? Oh, I didn't think about that. He tore my plan to shreds. Now, he was organizing school in earnest, himself. So the next year, he said, Daisy, I want you to organize the school. See, I had learned, that's the way he taught, by having you to do things. And then he told me when I was breaking down the boiler and driving the school, he said, I hope you never have to do it. But if you do, you will know how. You see where I'm giving him a testimony, don't you? The school was Morgan's name for him. We still meet, we still talk. If I have a problem or a concern or issue that's related to education or something I'm doing, I talk to him. He's in poor health. In fact, he mentioned that I took him to a picnic, the retirees picnic, last year. And he didn't want a woman to pay for him going to lunch. $15 a woman paying? No. I said, well, you are my guest. And I said, well, next year, you'll pay for yourself. And that's when he said, Daisy, I don't know that I would be here next year. So, trying to cheer us up, I said, well, if you're here, you will pay for yourself. Now, I've got to call him because the picnic is coming up. But when you are going through any situation, it really depends upon the people with whom you work, especially those who are in charge, to make sure that everybody is treated with compassion, that everybody's voice will be heard, even though you may not want it to be heard, but you got to make sure. And you got to make sure that the people with whom you work can have every advantage to grow and develop and become, and this is children too, all that they are capable of becoming. Now, how I'm going full circle, I left Clemmons when I was assistant principal, went into human services with the school. I said, school system didn't know what to do with me. So I went to human services. Then I was sent to South Fork temporarily. Then I was assigned to Latham. And then I got the call that you are going back to Clemmons as principal. Every principal should have the experience of going back to a setting that was simply wonderful. I didn't have to worry about the teachers. The teachers didn't have to worry about me because, and in fact, they said that I was just like Frank Morgan, which meant that they knew what was expected. They knew that I was going to encourage them. They knew that I was going to have their back, but also the children. My philosophy is that if you want respect as an adult, you got to give it even to children. And you can't expect children, I don't care who they are, to be adults. They are children and you have to teach them. And you have to model the behavior that you want.
And everybody said,
amen.
I'm just telling you.
Well, both at that time and looking back from today, how successful would you say the policy of integration or desegregation?
In general.
It's not successful, in my opinion. The ideal of integration would be, to me, sharing. It would be valuing what everybody brings to the table. That's not what happens. We still have a double standard, even for the kids. When you talk about the students and how to manage them. And everybody knows this. This is common knowledge about the black boys being, you know, the most prone to being suspended or expelled. I mean, it's just a double standard. when we talk about desegregation, and all of us know that our school system is really resegregated again. So to me, it has been a failure. If we would get to the point where we really, and I try to teach this to my kids about the golden rule, if we really treat others the way we want to be treated, to me, we can achieve that integration, but it hasn't happened. It just hasn't.
I'll say, like democracy, integration is a great experience. And I think, or at least speak for myself, integration means that I went into other settings. I think integration means that all people go into a new setting. Mm-hmm. So the front of integration really was born on the backs of black children. And so even in the original assignment plan, well, I was describing to you the 33222, I only went to school in my neighborhood for a few years, and I was bused to school for most of my career. So then, you know, so Brown versus Board of Education really was about having the same educational experience. So integration was the method by which the Supreme Court decided to make that happen. So the experiment, when there was required busing, we had schools that reflected the demographics of the community. When that mandate, well, when the vestiges, if you will, of a dual education system ended, the school systems across the country were told that you could no longer bus to integrate. And so school systems had to develop plans that would still seek to have integration, but not using busing. So now what we have a plan that is based on trying to attract students to schools across the county, and students have the choice to do that. So it's a tough notion to say, go to this school or go to that school when this school is right down your street. And our communities are reflective of what our students look like.
I guess I should have shared this. I worked at Reynolds Tobacco Company for 20 years, so I didn't go straight into education. And one of the things that I remember when Reynolds started providing health care and dental care, I don't know if you all are familiar with those programs, but anyway, we got to choose the physician or doctor we were going to. So a lot of the people I worked with, white people, would say, oh, they selected the black doctor because they knew if the black doctor was one of the doctors, he had to be the best. I had never thought about it. And so when Ms. Daisy said this about having a master's going into Clemmons, but then at North, where the black students were, the teacher didn't even have a college education, it was still that double standard being practiced. We still have to be, as black people, doubly qualified. When I think about desegregation, the whole point of it was really as a result of the law was to undo the segregation. I don't know if integration was really the intent. I don't know.
It was forced. No, where we are now, it's not successful. It never has been successful. But I've been in this education long enough, I've worked with people long enough that I think I have the answer.
All right now. All right.
Get ready for a ride. Draw and assign. that has equality, look at where the children live, draw the plan based on that. So you don't have anybody being bused unless there's some reason. Equity in drawing the plan, and not, well, we got to put these children over here, and these over here, and these over there. Look at them as children or as people, and make the assignment convenient for them. Would it happen? Then look at your finances. Look at your finances. Are they equitable? No. You may disagree with me, but no. And somebody may say, well, you know, some schools get more money than others. Money never solves educational problems. You got to have a strong curriculum. We know what to do to make education successful. We're playing games. We know, research has told us. We've had a successful plan at one time, and it was difficult. It was difficult to implement. Principal didn't want to do it. And I don't know about the school system people, but it died out before it could get really started. And it was called the Effective School Movement. And let me share how that came into being. Ron, Dr. M, is from the University of, I guess, Chicago or Detroit, I forget which one. But they did an experiment in which they went all over the country. It was two professors, Dr. Lazard and Ron Edmond, went all over the country and looked at schools and talked to schools that were supposedly successful. And they said, let's look and see what correlates make these schools successful, and if all the schools they were looking at had all of the seven correlates, then they would tag it a successful school. If they had six of the seven, no. They set up program based on what school, and I've forgotten now, it's been so long since I've worked with it, but parental involvement was one, a strong instructional leadership, a principal, who is the instructional leader, not the administrator. And there is a big difference between an instructional leader and an administrator. And I forget the others, but anyway, they were all good, and we set it up, and children was making a difference. Dr. Hunter was one of the people. How do people learn? She was a psychologist. How do people learn? Old people, young people, everybody. Black, white, how do they learn? And she set that up, combined it with the correlates of an effective school, set up this program, but it was too difficult. You hear? It was too, not for me, it was not, but I'm saying, we can't do that. Because it put all children in the same classroom, even those who were mentally challenged. And you may say, it won't work. I had a teacher at Clemmons, you put anybody in her classroom and they would learn, or she would kill them. I mean, she was so, she wasn't mean, but she was so focused. Children came out with special programs when they were in her room, because she didn't see them as special needs. She saw them as children. So again, and I could talk on it. See, I'm on my soapbox now. I could talk on it. Padilla proposal. I had my daughter talk somebody into going, using the Padilla proposal, which made by what, Socrates? Oh, we can't do that. Why can't we do that? I told somebody I wish I could go to Cook and be the principal at Cook and have the leeway to do whatever it is that I wanted to do. Now, I told my daughter that. I said, I wish I was younger. I would volunteer Not without pay.
Oh, I'm without pay.
If I were younger, that would be exciting to me. But I have to have the leeway. See, research, I'm not so smart I know all this. I'm basing what I'm telling you on research, what has been tried and what has proven to be effective. And look at how people learn and studying that. And the Maslow's hierarchy, having what little children do and studying. Dr. Hunter said this, teachers ought to be paid more than doctors, because when they are in that classroom, if they have 25 children or 20 children, they have to teach each one. Now, not I'm with this one, no. You have to think about each one, and you have to think all through teaching. You make your lesson plan today, and I had to make them, we all made them, but they're only good for the first 5 minutes, because then you got to...
That's right.
They're no good, mm-hmm. because you got to focus in on the student. As I said...
Your soapbox.
My soapbox. He's still working, that's why I keep it.
So Ms. Chambers talked about a lot of really kind of similar work in education, which educators still talk about, Dr. Evans and Lazat and Madeline Hunter. In fact, Dr. Geneva Brown, who Ms. Chambers worked with a lot, I had the occasion to speak at her memorial service, and I used to go to her house, and she just sit down. And Ms. Dr. Brown's very stern. You do what she tells you to do. And she would tell me about Madeline Hunter. And she actually gave me her set of original Madeline Hunter books. And when we were at her memorial, the teachers who she all had trained, they looked at each other and they said, she never let us touch those books. She let you borrow them. And I understood and appreciated greatly that opportunity. One of the thoughts I've had just sitting here thinking about integration and desegregation is, as a current school system employee, thinking about the demographics of the school system that we are currently in. So we have about 55,000 students. We are what you would call a majority-minority school district. We have more minority students than Caucasian students. And one of the benefits of integration, not just school integration, but society, is that many of the talented people, like these two ladies, who were in education 40 years ago, are now not in education. They have other opportunities. So they're doctors and lawyers and engineers. And so one of the things that we struggle with is, how do we attract talented teachers of color? They have other opportunities that they can go to. And I think what made me think about that is that what teachers are paid, regardless of your race, but what teachers are paid, it's a struggle when you can say, if you're in high school, and Monday night, Tuesday night, we did some scholarship, and we were recognizing students who were getting $250,000 scholarships to go anywhere in the world. And so how do we get those students to come back to what is likely the most difficult work that they can do? And they're not gonna be recognized much. Nobody's gonna pat them on the back. And most of the time, people are gonna complain about what they do. So it's a challenge. Mm-hmm. And so we look around, and we think about the 4,000 teachers that we have. How do we attract role models for students? And particularly African-American males. I mean, there are schools that have very few black male teachers. And so that's something that we struggle with.
Well, this has been a really important discussion. So before we open it up to the audience, are there any final thoughts you'd like to share?
I just want to say thank you for letting me relive some fond memories. Because I don't think about these things, you know, during the day. So thank you very much.
And I appreciate the invitation too. It's really been funny because even though Rosalyn, Ricky, and I have stayed in Winston-Salem, it's really been like the last maybe 15 to 20 years that we've even been asked to speak about our experience. And I did go over to Hill Middle School when I went there, it was a junior high, to speak to their history club. They never knew that the school had always been, or initially it was always white. They had no clue. You know, so I was thankful for that invitation.
Thank all of you for coming. Let's thank our guests. Questions from the audience? Yes, ma'am.
It's not really a question. My daughter, she's 59. She was in the first class where they went from the first part of the school year. So I was like the white parents. I did not want my daughter to ride the bus from Bon Air to Old Town. So I went and enrolled her at St. Benedict, ordered uniforms and everything, and she asked me, she said, Mom, am I riding that bus tomorrow? I said, no, your dad's gonna take it. I'm gonna pick you up. She said, I'm riding the bus. But she's always been taller than the other children, so she made money every week because we had to stop right in front of the door, and she would make sure the other little kids got on the bus and got back off, so she made her money all year. But I was a grandmother. I worked at manufacturing, so I would go to work at 4 a.m. in the morning so that I could be off in the evening. I went to all those little things, little baby food making classes and all that stuff. But when I went to the school, even my children went on to high school, I didn't have to go looking for them. When I pulled up on that campus, the children would go say, y'all mama here. And I even went, one was at North. And when she graduated from North, she was the only black girl on the baccalaureate for 2 years. And when she graduated, she went to ENT. And she said, mama, I have never seen so many black people in all my life. When she went to ENT. Well, my youngest daughter graduated from East and went to North Carolina State. I said, why aren't you in that nice going? Mom, our black children live over here on North Hill. We live over here. And they even had a separate homecomings and all that. I said, now, I done went through all that stuff with y'all and fussing with teachers and stuff, and you're gonna come down here and still be segregated. But she said, that is the thing. But I only had one problem in the school, a teacher at Mineral Springs told my daughter she couldn't be in the computer class. And so I asked her why. She said, because she rides the bus. I said, well, I pass this school every day because I took a lady home on the same street the school was on. And then that kind of made me mad. So I pulled out the next day, I pulled out this certificate. My daughter went to summer school at Elon and Appalachian and all those schools when she was a little girl. And I said, well, she has 17 hours of computer class, and if she can't be in, you're not going to have no computer class.
Uh-oh.
I'm just telling you like it was, and I didn't have a problem after then, but they were so, to say our children couldn't do things because they were bus riders, but they never asked the children if their parents have cars. And that's just the way it was. And when my daughter was in the battery, they made her into a steak. You know, she was not chilling like they got the girls dancing now. Mm-hmm. I said, you let those kids make you into a state? She said, yes, ma'am, because I was the only one there. And even my son was the quarterback at North in 1980 because they had a bad season and nobody wanted to step up. You got a quarterback 6'5". So I always went at the school, but I was one of them parents that did not want my daughter to ride the bus.
Now you bring up an interesting point. I forgot to share that when I went to Hill, I wanted to be in their dancing boots, whatever it was called then. You had to have shoulder length hair. You know, so, so I ended up being in the band.
I want to comment to parents. You brought this to my mind. You know, I've worked with some wonderful, wonderful parents, and then I've worked with some who didn't quite understand, and the school bus from Cleveland Avenue to Clemmons is a long ride, and the children, you know, would misbehave, some of them. And I asked the teachers, the staff at Clemmons, to let's have a PTA meeting in East Winston. And Reverend, it wasn't Reverend Lothian, Shallow. You go to Shallow. Mm-hmm.
Reverend
Butler. Who was it? Reverend Butler, maybe it was the, I can't remember who the pastor was, but I asked him, could we use a Shallow church? And then I asked the staff, would you be willing to travel? Because many of the black parents didn't come out to Clemmons. And I was trying to build a relationship. So surprisingly enough, most of the staff members said, yes, we'll go. And we met at Shiloh, and they were talking about, one parent got up and talking about the bus, and her children had been suspended from the bus, and all of this, and not treating the children fairly. And one parent stood up and said, I got four children. They ride the bus every day. And they have yet to get a bus ticket, to be put off the bus. They do what I say do. That one parent changed the climate. Because, you know, this one parent said, my children aren't having any problem. So how are you gonna get up and say, well, my children are having problems? So something must be wrong. But that one parent spoke up, and there are many, 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 many parents who care a lot and have gone through putting a 5-6-year-old child on a school bus, nobody with them that they know, going out to Clemmons. And they get off the bus, and many the first day they cry because they don't see anything that's familiar. And so what I did, the parents got angry with me because I told the staff at Clemmons, the first day of school, no parent would come into the building. Couldn't come in the first day. You know, want to bring my children, take them to the classroom? No. You stay outside. You look in the window. We'll send tissues out there for you. And we did. And you can cry looking in the windows. But our attention, all of our attention have to be on the children. And we can't deal with parents and children at the same time. So once they get off the school bus, I mean, come get to the school, they're ours. And I don't mean that in the ownership, but I mean our attention is focused on them. And any child that cried couldn't go in the classroom, because what happened if one child comes in crying?
Everybody.
All of them gonna cry. So my job, the assistant principal's job, was take any criers and do whatever we could do to, but they were scared. But one, I have to tell you this story because it was really funny. One little boy just boo-hooing. And I hugged him and he just didn't stop crying. So I was trying to get him away from the other children. So I took him in the cafeteria, and the cafeteria manager made me a cup of coffee, you know, while I was sitting there talking to the child, and he was just crying. I said, is there anything that I can do to stop you from crying? Yes. I said, what is it? Get me a cup of coffee. I had the cafeteria man make him a cup of coffee, and I said, if the superintendent walks in here and see this kindergarten sitting across this table drinking coffee, I'm gone. But anyway.
Yes, sir.
So the current conditions that we're dealing with now, I wonder if you all would be able to reflect maybe any lessons or anything you would draw from the desegregation, as you put it, of the schools, in the sense that right now we deal with this mass incarceration, the school to prison pipeline, and then the ever widening economic gap, huge inequality in America that primarily is a burden, even more so on the African American population. And is that a reflection, or do you feel it's a reflection of the civil rights movement that was truncated or limited in King spoke the last year of his life about these economic gains need to be made. Otherwise, civil liberties by themselves don't mean much, meaning we need social and economic rights. And I wonder if the school systems now, our public schools, are just a reflection of the civil rights movement that wasn't taken to the end that those civil rights folks that fought so hard for wanted.
I think it's a result of a lot, not just during that period of time, but history, if you look at history. But and you pinpointed a problem with identifying highly effective teachers, and that is a problem. However, the solution is to pay teachers a salary that they deserve. Then they won't run. And teachers should be highly paid, because I don't think many people realize how difficult teaching is, because teachers make it look easy. But it's not easy. Pay them. And not $45,000 a year. You got to give them a fair wage for what they do. And that was my statement to the North Carolina legislators. Pay teachers. And not you know, they're giving them now a little bit. Not a little bit. Pay them to do the job that needs to be done. Don't ask me where you're gonna get the money from. We get the money for everything else.
I was just going to ask you to come tomorrow, come to work. So to your question, I would say that school is a microcosm of society. And so I'm a product of my society. I'm not always looked like this. I'm not always going to put in the tile. So a few years ago, I would have had braids down my back. And when I did, I was not what people would perceive me to be successful in society. So black males, when they come to school, they're in a setting where they are not welcome necessarily, and they are not comfortable necessarily. So just like in the greater society, you have boys and young men trying to find their place, and schools have not figured out how to do that. And so we have to have models and strategies so that school is a welcome place. And I think the other part of that is, if you grew up in a neighborhood and somebody says, go to school because you can get this, and your this doesn't look like the this that they're telling you, where people have a house, have a car, have a career, you don't see what somebody's telling you to buy something that you don't see. So what do I get out of this? How do I make this work for me? So as an institution, we have to figure out how to make it comfortable for those boys to be in that place, and that there is an end for them, and that on the other side of high school and college, that a society will reward them for what they have done.
One more question,
I'll
finish. So in recent years, this community has really wrestled with, and at times been really locked at the corners around this question of how students are assigned to schools. And in terms of being in kind of a diametrically opposed, you know, it's forced busing, right? That language, or the language of controlled choice or neighborhood schools. And where it's left us is that a lot of parents and some folks even in this room who I know have wrestled on a regular basis with trying to figure out where to send their children to school so that their children have the best educational opportunities, and having to make that choice that leads them to not be able to have their children in diverse learning settings, which is a primary value for them, right? And it's a pretty heartbreaking place to see parents end up. And so I'm curious,
Because a lot of us in this room perhaps either don't have children in the schools right now, but feel very strong about education and really do believe in the value of an integrated and connected community. Instead of this notion of neighborhood schools or busing as though those are the only choices, to just have a moment to dream about, and I'm just curious, what you all think another way might be, a third way where we created spaces where every child had the best education and in learning environments that truly reflected the diversity of our community. Do you have a sense of how we might bring that into being in this community? And Dr. Simington, I'd love to hear your perspective to the extent you can speak to it, given your role as, you know, actively in the district, and I know that kind of can be tricky, but I just wonder, do you have a sense of what it could be? And Nora, since you're also in the district too.
I'll let them go first.
We all gonna get hire more teachers like Maurice Johnson over there. And you don't have to worry about where your child goes. Because I keep saying teachers are the key. And you can have any kind of redistricting plan you want to have, any kind of, schools are not the same. You can put money in, money doesn't always give the best results. So unless you can look at, and I'm going back to instruction. Let me ask you, how old are your children?
I don't have children.
Oh, okay. If we could guarantee that you could choose anywhere you wanted your child to go, and that child is going to have a strong instructional leader, there's going to be parental involvement, there's going to be a curriculum, not an administrator, but instructional leader is a principal, and teachers are well trained in, we talked about human growth and development, we talked about how people learn, we talked about we could guarantee you that, where would your child go? Where would you spend hours and upon hours thinking about where you want them to go, or would you maybe look at close proximity to where you live? Because those other issues wouldn't be there. That's why I say we know what to do. And because he's working, so this is his assignment. But I would redraw the assignment, the redistricting plan, come up with one that's fair and equitable. I would eliminate some of this choice. You would have a choice well. She might not. So that in itself is not going to be fair and equitable. So make all, and you know, this is not a pipe dream. You know, there are districts that are doing much of what I'm saying.
Used to be.
You're the one, you're on the hot seat, because you're there.
So obviously this is one of our challenges, and I think there's several layers to it. But one of the layers is, having grown up in this system, I am sort of the second generation, so I went through this process as a student. And now my friends and their families, black and white, their children are going through. So one of the things I think any kind of choice plan or student assignment plan is basically going to be successful when the recipients trust it. And I don't think we have either the experience of people in my generation. It was either not a good experience or an experience that was not received well. And so I think their parents are now expressing the view about their experiences growing up. So because of the law, and so this is where we are, the law before Brown versus Board of Education, the law as a result of Brown versus Board of Education, and then the law that exists now, which says you have to find other ways to integrate schools. So we have, through Department of Education, our biggest opportunity is what we call magnet schools. So how do we attract students and families to go to schools outside of their neighborhood? And it has to be a powerful thing. But the most powerful thing is what Ms. Chambers said. It has to be high quality instruction. So people are only going to go somewhere else when they think what is somewhere else is better than what they have. And if you believe that where you are is not good, then you're going to go somewhere else. Unfortunately, right now, we have a number of schools that have labels attached to them by the state. And those are predominantly in poor and minority neighborhoods. So the perception is that those are not good schools. And so people are not going to be drawn or attracted to them. So we have to infuse dollars, infuse strategies, infuse interventions into those things. But in a district that has 81 schools, we are not going to have 81 magnets. And how do we develop the trust in the community that all 81 of those schools are high enough quality that you feel comfortable having your child or your grandchild attend that school? And I don't have an answer, but I know that every day we think about that. And I would tell you that if I didn't think we could find an answer, I wouldn't be doing the work that I do every day.
I think it's a misnomer too, when you talk about the schools with the labels, to assume that because the grade of that school is poor, that the teachers are poor. And that's the lie that's being perpetuated. And so you're gonna find some of the hardest working teachers in the Title I schools. I mean, it's nothing for us to be there, you know, 5 and 6 in the evening. I mean, okay, so I think we're doing, on the whole, we're doing our part. But if people think that Vienna is better than going to a Cook or an Ashley because of the grade, that's what they're doing. But see, they're assuming that the best teachers are at those schools. And guys, I've worked at Clemmons. Those kids come into the school reading. I have kindergartners reading. Mm-hmm. And Morgan, I have kindergartners reading. That's not something the teachers did. I mean, not the teachers at school. The teachers at home did that, but not the teachers at school. And so they start off, you know, leg up. But when we just perpetuate that lie that the teachers are responsible for the, you know, the poor performance of the school. And I'm not saying that the teachers don't have a part in it. But there was a study by the state, I don't know if it was 8 to 10 years ago, when they found out, they came to the realization that these young white teachers teaching black men, a lot of times they're fearful or terrified. It just compounds the problem of how they deal with those students. The message is being sent, low expectations, you can't do, and it's a lie. But the kids will respond to that. We know that as teachers, low expectations will get low results. I mean, so.
And sometimes, I wasn't there, I didn't hear it, but I was told that one teacher said, this was an elementary school, that they taught to the children who were ready to learn. So I didn't hear the explanation about what happened to the rest of them. But when I was a principal at Mount Table, most of those students that came, the parents were very actively involved. And 89% of the student body was going on to higher education. Wake Forest was very involved with Mount Table. So you see, you're sitting, what do you have? You have parental involvement, you have people who are very concerned. You're having, you know, I couldn't get computers into the classroom because all the children had computers at home. You know, we were trying to, we need more computers at school. Well, they didn't see a need of having more computers at school. All of them had them at home. So they could, but those children who didn't have them at home, then we had to work to get them. But I'm saying schools are different. But if you talk about those seven Carleys, if you go back to that and measure that, you're going to find when those things in place, then schools are successful. Like you mentioned Bayonne. Mm-hmm. When I was at, I'm going to tell you this, I was at Clemmons, my principal, Frank Morgan, said, "Daisy, come and go to the tavern with me." I thought the tavern was where you sold drinks. And I thought, you shouldn't be going to the tavern. And I know I shouldn't be going to the tavern. Again, you have to know Frank Morgan. So Daisy said, "We're going down to breakfast at the tavern." So we went. When I walked, it was Clemmons Kitchen. That was the tavern. When I walked in, and you probably know, there was a table with 14 men at the table. This was when I was coming to Clemmons as principal. The 14 men were sitting there. The mayor, and Felix Hege, I can't remember what, but he was some big official in Clemmons. All of these were leaders in the community, men. And they said to me, "Daisy," now I had an enroll because these people knew Frank. And Frank had put his stamp of approval. So I had a step in with from the beginning. They said, "Daisy, don't you worry about finances. You tell us what you need. You concentrate on the instructional program and student learning." And I didn't worry about finances. What we wanted, we told them, and they got it for us. When I was at Latham, we had to struggle to get parents in. Volunteers were beneficial. They may not have had children, but they would come in out of an interest. So you see how schools are not the same. Schools are not equal. We can do the best we can to make them as equal as we can.
Thank you to all of you, and thank you to our guests.
Question. I just wanted to say, I do have a question, I'll talk to people later about it, but I just wanted to thank you, Ms. Harris, for setting up the series of programs. I have attended the other one and now this one, and I'm looking forward to the next one. It's really great. I'm new to the community, and it's nice to have this opportunity to learn about the community. It's from the real people that work.
You've been a joy to work with, and I also want to just mention that the part of her work in programming this series have been academic papers, and what's going to happen with those is that they will become the basis for a next big digital exhibit that we're going to be doing about civil rights and civil action in Winston-Salem. So there's a capstone student from UNCG at the Museum Studies program that's going to start off with your work and build upon it. Living on. Thank you all very much. This, every time we have a program, I'm like, that's my favorite. And y'all have kind of wrecked it for me because it was just so good. And I think that we can have these conversations. I wish that we can have them with the entire community to hear perspectives that really aren't shared too often. So thank you so much. I have a little gifty thing for you. Our friends with the Society of the Study for Afro-American History have donated some books to go along. So these are wonderful resources. We use them often here. So thank you all very much.